Lord, we call to you, come quickly to save. Give ear to the cries of our hearts, and let our prayers be counted as incense before you, the lifting of our hands as a sweet sacrifice before your throne. Deliver us, O Lord, from evil men. Preserve our lives from the violence. Those who plan evil things in their hearts and stir up wars continually, deliver us from the hands of the oppressor. God, we pray to you because you alone are the hope of our hearts, and you alone are the hope of this world. From you comes deliverance, from you comes victory, from you alone comes salvation. So come quickly, Lord, and hear the cries and answer the prayers of your people who are oppressed, who are brokenhearted, who are in need of freedom, justice, salvation, and deliverance. Hear the cries of the parents. Hear the cries of the children for healing. God, bring healing for Eric and for Ava. We plead the blood of Christ and the power of Christ's blood to run through the veins of these children, destroying the cancer cells and breathing new life within these precious bodies again. Answer the cries of these parents. God, answer the cries of the hundreds of parents whose daughters have been kidnapped in Nigeria. We pray for their safety, their freedom. We pray for a safe reunion with their families again. And we pray for justice for their oppressors. And God, we give you this time as your time for your people to have unhindered worship, encountering the hearts of the living God today. So open our ears to hear your voice, our eyes to see your beauty, our hearts to receive your word with joy and gladness, to be changed by your life-giving word today. And I ask, God, that you'd speak through me life-giving truth, saving lives by the power of your cross, sanctifying your saints, and let all be done to the glory of your name. So let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. And it is in the matchless, most powerful name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You know, there is a true story that I heard from a pastor who was traveling, and his story changed my life in a way that I never would have realized. After hearing the story, I understood the power and the necessity of prayer in the life of ministers. This pastor was traveling, as he does often, on an airplane, and as he usually does, he likes to strike up conversation with those seated next to him. And if there is an opportunity, he would share the gospel. On this particular flight, as he was headed toward his seats, The person that he was going to sit next to was already seated. And he sat down, and as he was about to introduce himself, he noticed that the man next to him was praying. And his eyes were closed, he was mumbling prayer to himself, and in his hands were a list of names. And so the pastor was like, oh nice, I'm next to a Christian today on this flight. And not only is a Christian, he is a man of prayer. And so he was looking forward to talking with him as soon as this man would finish praying. As the plane took off, the man did finally open his eyes, and the pastor finally had an opportunity to introduce himself. He said, hi, I noticed that you were praying, so I didn't want to interrupt you. Just wanted to let you know that I'm a Christian too. What church do you go to? To which the man replied, the Church of Satan. I'm a leader there, and I just finished praying through this list of pastors in my city that they would all fall. Afterwards, this pastor realized, like never before, that we are in warfare. The warfare is real. There's an enemy that is out there to steal, to kill, to destroy. And that's also why we are doing this new series on how to pray for your pastor. And the reason for this series is because I felt the strong need to increase prayers within our church and to increase intercessory prayers for our leadership team. There has been an increase in warfare this year, but also the past several years, especially as we have been moving deeper to the things of God's heart for the vulnerable within our communities. And so because of the increase in warfare, it is clear that there must also be an increase in prayer by the people of God. Last week, we looked at why pastors need intercessory prayers. So if you weren't here last week, I'd encourage you guys to listen to that message to get the overview of the motive behind this series. And for the remainder of this series, for the next couple of months, I will go through practical ways to specifically pray for the pastors and myself, for the ministers within your life. And for today, we begin with one of the most crucial prayers to pray for pastors, and that is for protection. So you could follow along with me in your outline and also open your Bibles to the text, Ephesians chapter 6. So we're going to be going through various verses, but not all the verses of the Ephesians passage is in your outline. So I ask that you just keep your Bibles open to Ephesians 6 as we will look at this in a moment. And in your outlines, you could also follow along right now. And we begin today by learning one of several important ways as to how to pray effectively prayers of protection for the ministers and pastors in your life. And the first thing that I want to teach us today is that we need to pray for protection against temptation. So everyone repeat, pray for protection against temptation. Luke chapter 22 verse 40 says, and when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. So in this verse, Jesus is engaged in serious spiritual warfare. He is on the Mount of Olives. He is about to face the cross. He is about to die. And literally, at possibly the greatest crossroads in history. And he asks his closest disciples to pray with him, because his soul is in anguish. You see, the enemy is strong at work right now. The enemy wants to take down Jesus. The enemy wants to take down the disciples. Satan has asked to sift Peter as wheat, as we looked at last week. The disciples will be tempted to leave Jesus, to betray Jesus, to deny Jesus. So Satan is working hard to bring down the servants of Jesus. And so Jesus, knowing this, feeling this, sensing the spiritual warfare that is thick in this time, he asks his closest disciples to pray with him. And the instruction that he gives to them is to pray that you will not fall into temptation. But this isn't the only time, and this was not the first time that Jesus gave these instructions to his disciples. In fact, when he was teaching them what we now know as the Lord's Prayer, within the Lord's Prayer, he also teaches them, pray like this, lead us not into temptation. And so Jesus is revealing something very crucial for us to learn about prayer, temptation, and how we need to understand the role of prayer in the midst of this spiritual warfare that we are in. He reveals to us that prayer plays a vital role in the protection against temptation. You see, prayer can release the power of God upon his servants. Prayer can release the grace of God to cover over the servants in our fight to overcome temptation. Therefore, he teaches them, pray that you will be protected from temptations. And that is how we need to be in prayer for the spiritual leaders within our lives as well. Amen? You see, there is an epidemic across the nations of falling pastors all over the world for the past several decades. The top reasons for pastors dropping out of ministry that we looked at last week were because of burnouts, discouragements, moral failure, and church conflict. The lure of money, the lust of the flesh, has disqualified far too many pastors from continuing on in ministry. And also, as we mentioned last week, that the pastoral profession is one of the highest professions for stress and heart disease that impacts the longevity of a life. That it is also one of the highest professions for stress levels and extremely unrealistic expectations by people, by peers, by congregation members. And it is a lonely and difficult road also. It is so lonely because of the crazy expectations that are expected of pastors and the distance that oftentimes pastors feel from people, from the congregation members, and it makes them feel they do not have real friends to confide in. In fact, another survey revealed that 70% of pastors said that they have no close friends to confide in, to share struggles with. 70% of them. And on top of the 90% of the pastors who work 50 to 80 hours per week, most of them feel that their work is never ending. 54% also revealed in a survey that they viewed pornography within the past year. 54% of pastors. 50% of pastors' marriages will end in divorce. 40% said that they started having an affair after beginning ministry. 70% fight depression. And these are just a small part of why 1,500 pastors leave the ministry every month. This is a clear message to the church that there is great warfare for the pastors in your life. And this is a clear message that pastors need your prayers, especially prayers of protection. Amen. There is great warfare and great temptation for the pastors and spiritual leaders in your lives. So how are these factors connected? There is high stress, high expectation, high warfare, high isolation, which leads to high levels of temptation. Just last month, Bob Coy, who is the senior pastor of the 18,000-member church of Calvary Chapel in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, stepped down from his role due to the revelation of a moral failure that was going on for several years. In fact, at the time of his resignation, he was in the top 15 podcast sermon downloads on iTunes. But he joins three other megachurch pastors who fell also within the state of Florida all within the past year. Other high-profile pastors are now under scrutiny, both in the U.S. and North America, for their lavish use of money on large homes, fancy cars, and even private jets, all in the name of ministry expenditures. There are great temptations that must be fought in the spiritual realm on our knees. And the principle we learn from these verses and from the heart of Jesus to his disciples is that the more we pray for our pastors, the more protected they will be. But the less we pray for our pastors, the less covered they will be, the less protected they will be, and the more vulnerable they will be for the attacks from the enemy. You see, there is a direct correlation between intercessory prayers and the protection of people. Therefore, cover your pastors in prayers of protection against temptations. Amen. I don't want to be a stat. I don't want any of our pastors to be a stat. And I want us to cross the finish line faithful in the end. But if that's going to happen, pastors are going to need the prayers of the people. Some people find it hard to think like this, but pastors are fully human, fully frail, fully sinners, just like you. And we are in need of his grace. We are in need of your prayers if we are going to finish well. Amen. Another way for us to pray is to pray for protection against evil. So everyone repeat, pray for protection against evil. Let's look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Finally, brothers and sisters, pray for us that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored as happened among you. And pray, look at verse 2, that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. For not all have faith. So Paul asks for prayers of protection so that he would be delivered or saved from wicked and evil men. And the reason he gives for that, he says, because not all have faith. Now, why does he say that? Pray for protection for me against people who do not have faith in Christ. Why does he say that? Because how we respond to the gospel determines how we treat others. People who love the gospel love those who declare the gospel. But those who are hostile to the gospel will be hostile to the preachers of the gospel. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first, is what Jesus reminded his followers. And the hostility towards the gospel and the church continues to grow at speeding rates in our generation like never before. In the U.S. now, if you are a Christian, you'll be looked down upon and told to keep your beliefs to yourself. You see, in the name of tolerance, you can believe and practice anything you want now except Christianity. We are now in a post-Christian, no, scratch that. We are now in an anti-Christian generation. And we will be hated because we love Jesus. And you need to be aware of that. That's what it means to count the costs as we take up our crosses to follow Jesus. Amen? Also, if you were not aware, most of the hundreds of the Nigerian girls that were kidnapped and threatened to be trafficked this past week that we prayed for earlier today in the service, most of them were Christians. And also, not too long after they were kidnapped, the leader of the kidnapping group, he told reporters that these girls have been successfully, quote-unquote, in his words, converted to Islam. Also in the news recently, a 26-year-old pregnant Sudanese woman faces the death penalty by hanging because she would not deny Christianity and convert to Islam, and for marrying a Christian. This is the direction that the world is headed in. So we must pray for protection against the evil that is growing in our world. For those who hate God will hate the people of God. You see, sometimes the enemy will use unbelievers because they are not filled with the Holy Spirit to cause them and influence them to stir up trouble for the believer. And that is why Paul says, pray for me to be delivered from evil, because not all have faith. Because the enemy can influence and use others who do not have the same faith as us to stir up trouble and to increase persecution. And that is why Jesus also teaches us the prayer in the Lord's Prayer, teaches us to pray, deliver us from evil. My family and I are in desperate need of these prayers of protection from evil. For the past few years especially, as we've been seeking to fight to end sex trafficking in Korea, the warfare has definitely increased within our lives. You see, this trafficking industry is a multi-billion dollar industry. There are deep levels of deception and corruption even amongst government officials and law enforcement agents. There is great evil that is controlling this industry. And they don't like it when someone tries to get in the way of their profits. And so I already know there are people in this government and beyond who really do not like me or OEM because we are bringing to light a lot of things they want kept in darkness. And so there is great evil, and there are people who will be influenced by great evil who do not like this ministry or your pastors in this ministry. And so we need prayers of protection against evil. Amen? I need them. But before we start to demonize people, saying, okay, yeah, I always knew governments were evil. I always knew the police were evil. Before we start to say, they're evil, before we start to demonize them, we need to take a step back and remember where the real source of attack comes from. And because of this, we need to pray for protection against the enemy. So everyone repeat, pray for protection against the enemy. And then Paul reveals in Ephesians 6, now let's look at Ephesians 6, starting from verse 11. Not all our opposition that we face in this world are really our opposition. And Paul explains. Ephesians chapter 6, starting from verse 11. It says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of who? Of the devil. Verse 12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. So Paul reveals in Ephesians 6 that the real source of our conflicts, of our opposition, is not against other people, but against other principalities in the spiritual realm. So while we do need to pray against evil, we ultimately need to pray against the work of the evil one. That is our true enemy. Amen? Not people. People are not our enemy. Because the enemy's goal in attacking spiritual leaders especially is to discredit, destroy, and ultimately to bring to death the spiritual leadership within the church. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, he is our adversary. He prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. So be alert and realize who the enemy really is, seeking ways to take you out and take out your leaders. You see, in every battle, the top prize is to capture and take out the leader of the opposition. Because if you could take out the leader, the rest will be easier to deal with. You need to know that the enemy's aim is to attack leadership first and with force. Because as Jesus teaches us, strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. Strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. There is a city in South America several years ago who had within their one city 7 pastors fall due to moral failures. And what is the impact that it had upon that city? Thousands upon thousands of people left the church to never return again. Why? Because think about it. Suddenly you hear the news, this pastor fell in this church. One. And then the second church down the block. And then the third church down the street. And then the fourth church in the other part of the city. And then the fifth church in the other part of town. And then the sixth church in this part of the neighborhood. And then the seventh church. And after 7, the people no longer trusted the spiritual leadership anymore. You see, there's a big difference in the effects that a fall will have within a congregation member versus the senior pastor. Why? Primarily because of character, influence, and integrity. If a church member falls, people may be surprised, sad, angry, judgmental, gossip, but most of the people will still attend the church. But if the pastor falls, that will have a far greater ripple effect to shatter the trusts and to scatter the flock. Non-Christians, nominal Christians, they judge, leave, and never return. The committed will feel betrayed. The core is shaken because the future is now unknown. So pray for protection from the enemy who wants to influence destruction and division so that the influence of the spiritual leaders are destroyed. You know, there is a married couple who were once in satanic worship. They met Christ, were delivered from these satanic occults, and now they are strong believers within their church. And there was an interview being done by them, by this pastor, who came across their testimony of what life was like for them when they were worshipers of Satan. And they revealed something very striking and very saddening about what life was like for them as they were worshipers of Satan. In this interview, they revealed that their group and many groups like them would regularly pray to Satan, cast spells, and speak curses against the pastors within their city. And they said there are 3 areas that they would always pray against the pastors within their lives. First thing, they said that they would pray to Satan to destroy their finances, their financial integrity. 2, they would seek to destroy their families and marriages. And 3, they would seek to destroy their health. Because for them, the unhealthier they become physically, the sooner their life will be cut short and die, and they will no longer be in existence to minister the gospel anymore. And so as they discovered this, it changed these churches' strategies of how to pray as well. Peter Wagner reveals in his book Prayer Shield that it has now become known that over the last several years, Satanists, witches, New Agers, occult practitioners, shamans, spiritists, and other servants of darkness have entered into an evil covenant to pray to Satan for the breakdown of pastors, their marriages, their families, their health. It has become clear that the spiritual warfare has intensified. And C.S. Lewis once said, "There is no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch and every split second is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan." We are in warfare, and we need to pray for our leaders who are on the front lines of this battle. Amen. Bill McRae is a chancellor at two prestigious evangelical institutions. And the reason why I need to frame it like this, because I know that I'm speaking a lot about spiritual warfare, even mentioning satanic worship and things like that. I know there are going to be some of you like, oh, you're getting into that kind of super woo spiritual kind of stuff. But this came from a leader of two strong evangelical schools near Toronto, Canada, the Ontario Bible College and the Ontario Theological Seminary. Previously, he pastored North Park Community Chapel as well, and he reported this while he was a pastor. Quote, "It was brought to our attention that a group of Satanists who worshipped in a church situation within London, Ontario, had committed themselves to pray to Satan for the elimination of a number of our evangelical leaders in the city through marriage and family breakdown. During that particular summer, this cell group of Satan worshippers located in London, Ontario, they were honored at their gathering of other worshippers of Satan, at this particular convention, they were honored with an award for their effectiveness and success in their work over the past year. Why did they win this award?" McRae says, "In the course of the previous year, they had succeeded through their endeavors of cursing, prayer, and declarations of darkness to bring down five extremely influential pastors within their city through moral breakdown and destructions of marriages." Bill McRae said that he was very moved and broke down in tears when he found out the reason why this group won the award, because he was friends with one of the five pastors whose life became a living hell for the past couple of years before it was made known. He says, "We were very much aware of the desperate need for prayer, but I must frankly confess, none of us was quite as alert to the reality of the satanic warfare that we were fighting in until it was all over. And unfortunately, that's often when people realize how serious the situation was, when the damage was already done." We need to be in prayer for our pastors. Pray for protection against the enemy. Amen. And one more piece of advice that I want to give to us today is to pray for protection with the armor of God. So everyone repeat, pray for protection with the armor of God. Pray for protection, how? Through praying through the armor of God. It is wise to pray through Scripture and let God's Word be your guide in teaching you how to pray. And a great way to pray for your pastor's protection is by praying through the armor of God into their lives. Look at Ephesians 6, verses 14 and following. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So pray for the belt of truth to be strong within the life of your pastors. Upholding the truth of the gospel at all times, never compromising, always bold, living out Romans 1:16, that I will never be ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for the salvation of all who believe. Pray for the breastplate of righteousness to protect the hearts of your pastors from compromise and of half-heartedness and of apathy. Pray for the shoes that are ready to go and obey wherever God calls with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Pray for the shield of faith to be strong, extinguishing all the flaming arrows of the enemy, as Paul tells us it will do. Pray for faith to remain intact, to trust and treasure Christ above all other things and as supreme over all circumstances and over all the attacks in life. Pray for the helmet of salvation to protect the minds and the thoughts of your leaders, that the assurance of salvation and our identity in Christ would be our joy and our delight. Pray for a growing knowledge and love for the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit, the weapon of the Word, to be used well within our lives. But we don't stay focused on the enemy because our God is greater. And Jesus has already won. The victory is His. Therefore, the victory is ours. You see, Satan is a defeated enemy who knows that his days are numbered. But before the final days here on earth, he wants to bring down as many people with him as possible, so the war appears as if it is still raging on until Jesus returns. You see, the battle has been won, but Satan still has some lingering bullets left in his gun. And so he's going to keep shooting while he's going down, until he's finally locked up for all of eternity. And the reminder for us today is that there is power in prayer because prayer connects us to the ultimate power source, and that is Jesus who rules over all. Amen. You see, there is power in prayer, and there is power in prayer to protect the people who are prayed for. One of the many testimonies that I heard from missionaries on the mission field concerning the effectiveness of prayer for the ministers of the gospel came from a very rural part of Africa. And in this part of Africa, this missionary couple was in an unreached, unengaged part with very hostile tribes, knowing that they were there to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they did not want any part of it. But thankfully, this missionary couple had a strong praying church supporting them on the mission fields. And so, as they were ministering, one day, they realized, they sensed that people were very unhappy with their presence there. But they still tried to minister, share the love of God, share the gospel. And then that night, as they were in their small home, they saw outside torches of light surrounding their home. And then these tribesmen, they were beating down their door and their window, saying, "Come out here, we want to kill you, we don't want you here anymore." So obviously this missionary couple was very fearful. And so they ran into their bedroom, they locked the doors, and they got on their knees to pray. And they were praying. And because of the time change, this was evening for them, it was in the afternoon back in the U.S. where their sending church was at. And it was daytime, and suddenly some of the people in the church prayer team got a sudden urge, we need to pray for this missionary couple. And so they called an emergency prayer meeting, calling everybody who would come to the church, come now. And then as they were calling, they also, several of the other church members were feeling the same thing. They're like, I felt the same thing. And I started praying, come over here. And so they gathered together as quickly as they could. But because of work schedules and various other things, only 12 of the church members could gather at the church. And they were fervently in prayer for the next several hours. And then for this missionary couple, as they prayed throughout the night, they fell asleep, as a lot of us do when we pray at night. The next morning, in relief, they realized that they were still safe. And also, the next morning, they received urgent phone calls asking them, are you guys okay? Because several hours ago, we all felt an urge to be in prayer for you. And they shared, thank you so much. It must have been because of your prayers that we are okay. And they shared the story that just several hours ago, people from around the community, they were banging on the door. They were trying to bring them down. They wanted them dead. And so we were praying. And when they asked what time, they matched up the time, and it was the exact same time that the attack was happening. And that, if we end the story there, that would have been pretty cool, right? But that's not the end of the story. They continued to minister in their villages, and eventually people started getting saved. In fact, the village chief also got saved. And so they began talking and discipling and celebrating the salvation of key people and key influential people within their communities. And if that was the end of the story, that also would have been cool. But that's not the end of their story. As they became good friends with the believers and the village chief, they actually asked him one day, hey, you know, a while back, I know that a lot of the village people were very upset and they tried to break down our door one night, threatening our lives. And he says, ah, yes, I remember that night. Yes, we all gathered together and for some reason, all of us were very angry and we wanted to see you all dead. And so the missionary couple asked, why did you guys leave then? And he answered, oh, very simple. Because as we looked inside your window, we saw 12 strong soldiers, all dressed in white with swords. And we all fled in fear. And the missionary couple, I'm sorry, how? What did you see? How many? We saw 12 white soldiers, dressed in white, with huge swords. And so we fled. And then the missionary couple looked at each other. They called back their home church and also asked, hey, how many did you say gathered for that prayer meeting that night? And apologetically, they're like, oh, we're so sorry. Only 12 of us were able to gather that day. And for them, they realized the power of prayer and the protection of the ministers of the gospel. Your prayers have power because prayers connect you to God. And prayers release the power and the grace of God over those prayed for and over those who are praying. And that is why we need to pray faithfully and daily for the protection of your pastors. And may we grow to be a prayer shield for the shepherds in our lives. Amen.
Jesus.